I've been ready since I got here.
Okay, Joe. Go ahead, Joe.
Good evening. Welcome to the Barefoot Bay Recreation District Board of Trustees regular meeting for August 25th, 2020. As we do before each board meeting, we would like to take a moment of silence to remember all our service personnel, both past and present, who have or are still fighting to protect this great country we live in. Let's also remember our Barefoot Bay residents, both past and present. We will follow this with a pledge of allegiance to the flag led by Trustee Henderson. Let's now have a moment of silence, please. Thank you, Luann. Thank you for coming. Trustee Compton, would you please do the roll call?
Yes, Chairman Klosky, are you here?
Yes.
Trustee Mino?
I am here.
Trustee Henderson?
Yes.
Trustee Compton is here. Trustee Loveland?
Yes.
Also with us, we have John Coffey, our district manager. We have Stephanie Brown, our district clerk, and we have Cliff Reppinger, our general counsel. We also have with us Matt Goetz, our property services manager, as well as Chris Armington, our resident relations manager. We have a quorum, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Roger. Next thing on this is a proclamation, and normally we would have the trustees come up to the podium, but with this pandemic, and we're going to just have just me and the thing there. 6 foot distance. Thank you. Barefoot Bay Recreation District's Labor Day Proclamation. Whereas workers in all industries and professions have contributed to the labor force and the success of the United States in the past, present, and will continue in the future, and whereas on June 28, 1894, President Grover Cleveland signed a law making the first Monday in September of each year a national holiday, and whereas we recognize September 7, 2020 as Labor Day and mark the 126th anniversary to celebrate, and whereas without our diverse employees serving in the Department of Administration, Resident Relations, Property Service, Food and Beverage, and Golf, the exclusive benefits our residents enjoy today would not be possible. Now be it resolved by the Board of Trustees of Barefoot Bay Recreation District that Monday, September 7, 2020 is proclaimed Labor Day, and the Board of Trustees will recognize and thank all Barefoot Bay employees for their dedication and who by combined efforts have assigned in the growth and prosperity of Barefoot Bay Recreation District. Passed and adopted by the Board of Trustees, Barefoot Bay Recreation District is 25th day of August 2020, Board of Trustees, Barefoot Bay Recreation District, Barefoot Bay, Florida, signed by Joseph Klosky, Chairman. Thank you. A lot more people than that.
Oh yeah, couldn't you tell?
And I'd just like to thank Matt and Rich here for all the hard work they do, and John chose them a long time ago as the supervisors of that department, and as far as I'm concerned, everybody he picked, he has a good track record, because nobody has ever failed him, and they never failed the residents or the trustees or nobody. So, Matt, congratulations, and Rich, congratulations on the great work you do, and keep on continue doing it. Thank you. I would like somebody to make a motion on that to approve that.
I'd move we accept the Labor Day proclamation with gratitude to our employees.
A motion made, second.
I'll second it.
And all in favor of that motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes. Thank you very much. The approval of minutes. We have a set of minutes for August 14, 2020 to be approved. Chair will entertain a motion to approve.
I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes as presented and written.
Roger made a motion. Second?
I'll second it.
Luann made a second. Any discussion or changes on the minutes? Hearing none. All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. Treasury report. Treasury Loveland, please read the Treasury report for August the 25th.
This is the Treasurer's report, August 25th, 2020. Cash balance in general fund, $2,500. Operating cash in banks, $2,159,428.96. Interest-bearing accounts, $698,353.64. Total cash balances in general fund, $2,860,282.60. Total daily deposits and assessments received for 8-7 through 8-17. Daily deposits, $13,151.01. Assessments received, $4,504.44. Total deposits received, $17,655.45. Expenditures over $5,000 for 8-7 through 8-17. One expenditure to ABM Landscape and Turf Services for $38,691.16. Total expenditures, $38,691.16. I submit the Treasurer's report.
Thank you, Randy. Chair will entertain a motion to accept the Treasury report as read. Luann made a motion. Second?
I'll second that.
Roger seconded. Any corrections or discussions? None? All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you very much. Next to the audience participation, John has a few letters he's going to read, and then he'll see if anybody's on the phone to talk. Thank you.
First letter is from Richard Schwatlow, 636 Marlin Circle. At the previous BOT meeting, after my audience participation was read, a board member stated that this was a working meeting and the board members do not have to answer questions. They said a resident can go to the administration building and staff can assist them. Prior to that meeting, I had gone to the administration building. I was informed that a board member does not have to answer a question, but they have the ability to do so if they want. They have answered questions by me in the past. I feel I am asking the board a question that needs to be answered and put on record by the board. Within the lounge plans in Building A, has the board taken into consideration if renovation will be adjusted to meet current health concerns by installing air conditioners with hospital-grade filter systems, and will there be an air recycling system to meet suggested concerns over occupants' health by the CDC? Also, will there be a retrofit to all other buildings, offices, recreation, and commercial locations? I feel the residents need to know that if $2 million that they will be spending on Building A and the lounge have been addressing safety issues concerning the virus that could affect our health and use of all buildings in the Bay for an unknown time frame. We may want it now, but we want it right. This past Sun on the news, it stated that Florida is now starting to retrofit its air recycling systems on the school system to help protect our youth and adults. Can we do any less? What is the board doing? A letter from Charles and Darlene Kelly of 555 Marlin Circle. Limitation of assessment and ability to collect assessment. Keeping the assessment no greater than CPI is and should be the policy of the district. Many in Barefoot Bay are dependent upon Social Security and pensions that are tied to the CPI. In 2005, the CPI was at 3.42%, but dropped to 2.54% in 2006. In 2007, climbed to 4.08% and then receded to 0.09% in 2008. More graphically, in 1979, climbed to 11.35%, and by 1986, dropped to 1.1%. The problem with linking taxes assessments to the CPI is that there is no rollback relief when the index recedes. Therefore, it would be prudent to keep any assessments below the CPI. Yes, the recreation district should adopt the do less, better mindset. We, the district, should do all possible work out of a compromise with county board to continue our assessment to be collected at the county level. On phased reopening, we would suggest that Council Reppinger look into possibilities of the lounge obtaining a case-by-case per-in special events in per-in wine and beer permit tied to food ticket sales. Tickets would have to be presented for each and every adult beverage. Most people know we are eager to have some semblance of the, quote, bay, end quote. We are confident that Ms. Mendes and her senior staff could come up with some great ideas. A second letter from Richard Schwatlow of 636 Marlin Circle. At the past BOT meeting, I was really amazed that the board seemed surprised over Commissioner Tobias' statement on collection of assessments in the bay. Commissioner Tobias has stated in the past, and the board was aware, if the board raised the assessment over CPI, he felt it would be a burden to the residents of the bay, and there would be consequences if we did it. The board did raise the assessments over CPI and then raised it more to the nearest dollar. We are now looking at the consequences of doing so, concerning on how our assessment could be paid. If your boss tells you not to do something and you do it, you end up, like in school, told to stand in the corner. Too bad the residents have to stand there also and face the consequences. During this meeting, I hope the board and the commissioner will be able to work out their problems. A letter from Jack Reddy, Tamarind Circle. The current process for Barefoot Bay residents to pay their annual assessment has been successful and in effect since 2009 and is working well. The ballot referendum proposed by Mr. Tobias is not favorable to the 9,000 plus people of Barefoot Bay. It changes our concept of home rule and denies the Board of Trustees the ability to operate Barefoot Bay under strong fiscal plan and interferes with the lien process. I urge our trustees with John Coffey and our attorney to appeal by all legal means to keep our current process. The trustees must work for the betterment of all Barefoot Bay residents. Welcome to the Board of Trustees meeting. Please remember, you need to turn off your TV or computer at home or not use conference call feature on your phone. Please state your name, address, and you have 3 minutes. Hello, is anyone there? Hello?
One more time.
Is anyone there? Anyone like to speak to the Board of Trustees?
Audience participation is now closed. Thank you. We will now go to unfinished business, consideration of limitations of assessments rates via interlot agreement with Brevard County.
Chairman Klosky,
yes.
If I might make a recommendation, agenda old business A and new business A, while they're different, they're different issues, you almost can't speak about one without the other. Is it possible that we might could combine and have discussion of both of those items in this part of the meeting?
I think there was a possibility of potentially tabling 9A.
Yeah,
I don't know how the board feels about that. The board
I would suggest that 9A simply be eliminated from the agenda.
You want to leave it on the agenda?
I'm sorry?
You want to leave it and we're going to discuss it? Or do you want to table it?
Item 9A, I don't believe, after we get through discussing 8A, I don't believe there's a need to discuss 9A
okay.
at this time.
So do you want to discuss that at a future time or... Come not at
it,
all.
It all depends on what happens with 8A.
Okay, we'll see what happens. Okay.
That's just my suggestion.
Okay, no problem. Yes, okay, so okay. I'd rather just leave it the way it is, and when we get to that, we can see what we want to do.
But again, I'm not trying to get away from what you're doing. I'm just, if we look at the whole picture of what we're trying to do tonight, I'm not sure we want to go into 9A tonight.
I don't know that I can discuss one without getting involved in the other, because essentially, as a community, we're being given a choice between those two, right?
Well, I think tonight, again, we're on 8A right now, right? We haven't made a motion, in other words, to even get into discussion yet, so I'm not sure, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, let me withdraw my recommendation so we can move.
Okay, yeah, okay, and so I would make, again, the way it should go is we should make a motion, a second, and then it's either passed or it's denied, either one way, as you get the discussion.
Okay, so
I would make a motion that we consider, is that appropriate, maybe, Cliff?
Do you want me to just give some background information so I can...
You can, but you have to do that. I mean, we can't get into a whole hell of a lot of discussion on it until, I don't think, but you do need the background. Go ahead.
Just for those...
Yes. Sure.
Residents watching
Absolutely.
At home who
Go
may
ahead.
Not
they don't, they
quite
don't all know, understand it.
Sure. Have the background or be familiar with exactly what's happening.
Okay.
So the board may recall, and the residents watching at home may recall, that at the last meeting I advised the board that the county commission had passed a resolution calling for a referendum election related to the district's ability to collect its assessment via the uniform method of collection. During that meeting, Commissioner Tobia was the commissioner who brought that initiative forward to the commission, and the commission approved it back in May. During the meeting, and as we know, our district is entirely within Commissioner Tobia's district footprint. during that meeting and after the meeting, Commissioner Tobia had communicated with me that if the district was willing to voluntarily limit its increase of future assessment rates to the CPI index that is referenced in the county charter in which the county is subject to in terms of its millage rate and the other constitutional officers live within as well under the county charter, if the district was willing to subject itself or to voluntarily limit itself in its setting of its assessment rate moving forward, that he would bring an initiative or at least consider bringing an initiative to the county commission to rescind the resolution calling for the referendum election. After the meeting that we had, community manager John Coffey and myself had a conference with a telephone conference with Commissioner Tobia, and again he indicated that if the district were willing to subject itself to that limitation, that he would be willing to take that step. The question is, how do you accomplish that? And we weren't really 100% sure how the board would, if the board was willing to do that, would limit itself. My suggestion was that we do it via an interlocal agreement. And so what you have before you today is the consideration of an interlocal agreement with Brevard County, whereby the Barefoot Bay Recreation District Board of Trustees voluntarily agrees that it will limit future assessment rates moving forward to no greater than the CPI index that's referenced in the charter, in the county charter. There's a couple of different points related to that. Now, obviously, for this year, given the mandates of 418, we're limited in what we've done this year. We can't go back and undo what has already been done for the fiscal year coming 2021. So this agreement is scheduled to start with your next setting, with this board's setting of the next assessment rate, which would be prior to July 30th of 2021 for the fiscal year 2022 year. So that's when this agreement would, even though the agreement would take effect, that's the first assessment rate that that limitation could and would under the agreement apply to. If you look at section 3 of the agreement, in that section is language that effectively provides that the district will voluntarily agree to limit that increase to the consumer price index over any assessment levied in the immediately preceding year. Now, there's a provision that has been placed into that section B, which would allow for the district to go to the county commission in the event of a critical need or an emergency similar to what is provided in the county charter, to go ask the county commission to bless or approve of an amount that would fall within that category of need that would require the district to exceed that CPI rate in its assessment rate set. Again, that would be an issue that would be up to the county commission. The county commission would have to approve that via a supermajority, as they do in their charter for their other constitutional officers that are subject to that limitation. And so that would be an issue that would be subject to county approval that we would have to go and ask the county for if we wanted to raise over that rate. And obviously, you'd need to have a critical need or a emergency justification for that purpose. Section 4 then provides that based on that limitation, that voluntary limitation moving forward, that the county will continue to allow the assessment to be collected via the uniform method of tax collection. Subsection B of 4 provides that the county would take action to rescind the resolution that was approved calling for the referendum election on November 3rd, 2020. As to the question that's scheduled to be placed on the ballot. And then subsection C provides that if in any subsequent year of the agreement that the district fixes or adopts an assessment rate that exceeds the percentage that's set, that the CPI index for the preceding year, that the county can then call that referendum election on the question of whether to revoke the authority, so that the county can go back and call that question again if the district violates this agreement moving forward. The term and the effective date, again, this would be effective for that 2022 fiscal year, which you adopt that rate next, by July 30th of 2021. The agreement provides that its term is for 5 years, but then it has an unlimited number of five-year renewal periods unless it's amended by both parties. So both parties would have to then amend that. But this is an interlocal agreement adopted pursuant to the Interlocal Agreement Act. It would be recorded. It would be approved, obviously, by both parties. And it's as permanent an agreement for that purpose as I can possibly think to make it. So hopefully, if the board sees fit to approve this agreement, then this agreement would be sufficient to demonstrate to Commissioner Tobia that the district is committed to its limitation as he desires. And assuming that the county attorney's office has no problem with the form or content of this agreement, that they would then pass it on to the county commission for approval as well. And so that's where you're at procedurally. Now, just one kind of follow-up issue addressing the election. I've been in contact with per the direction of the county attorney's office, I've been in contact with the supervisor of elections office regarding the deadline dates. We are definitely on a time-sensitive schedule right now. The county commission met today. You are obviously meeting today. If you approve this, I will send this to the county attorney's office and to Commissioner Tobia immediately to get their feedback and any adjustments to it. If we had to meet again, assuming that this were approved, we could meet on notice if we had to. But the county commission's next regular meeting is, I believe, September 15th. That is going to be past the deadline at which time that the question could be removed from the ballot. When I spoke to the supervisor's office today, I was given a deadline date of September 1st to advise them that this could be removed from the ballot. Truthfully, I don't know whether the county can meet that time frame. We would have to discuss that with the county after, if the board approves this tonight, whether they could set a special meeting to meet that September 1st deadline. They do have a zoning meeting on September 3rd, and I did talk to the supervisor's general counsel this evening, and he was kind of evaluating the issue to see whether there was any flex at all in that September 1st date. So if there's a two-day flex there between September 1st and the 3rd, maybe if they can put this onto the zoning meeting and it meets with everyone's approval, that that language could then be pulled off the ballot on September 3rd. If we don't make that deadline to actually pull the language off the ballot, then the next best alternative would be, because you're going to be locked into what the ballot says, is to send out notices to the voters advising them that the question's not going to be counted. That is something that the supervisor would prefer not to do if they can avoid it. If that's the directive of the county commission and they rescind the resolution, then I guess we'll have no choice on that. It can be a costly endeavor because of the notices that are involved that would have to be mailed out. And you'd have to publish a public notice, which I assume then the district would bear the cost of doing those notices, unfortunately. But if that's the tack that we would have to take, then that would be the next best alternative. But the hope would be that we could somehow or another either give it to them on September 3rd and have that be sufficient, or possibly have the county have some type of a special meeting to consider it in advance of the 3rd, if that is at all even possible. And so that's where you're at from a timing perspective.
A couple of questions. You know, again, without going into discussion of 9A that we were mentioning a minute ago, I assume everyone on this board understands that this is something that we cannot let it happen. We can't allow this to go on the ballot and be approved in any way. So my question is this. The parts of this agreement that you have here, this has been negotiated with the county?
They haven't given their consent.
Not consent, but the parts of it have been discussed with them?
The limit that what we were told by Commissioner Tobia was if this board was willing to agree to that limitation, that would...
Well, my point is that because we're on this matter of hours of whether this happens, I'm just trying to make sure that there isn't something in here that somebody's going to throw out and say, no, hell no, we're not going to do that. And my point is, let's make sure it's not in there. If anything in there they don't like, that we think they don't like, that we've talked to them that we don't like, let's not do it. And if it's all good, yeah, that's fine. But we want to make sure that there's not something in there.
I can't imagine that there would be anything in this agreement, although... I can't speak for the county.
Yeah, I understand.
But I can't imagine that there would be anything objectionable, because there's nothing hidden in this agreement that would allow this district to do anything other than abide by this district or abide by this agreement or live with the consequences of a subsequent referendum call.
That's great.
So there's nothing we can do to get out. If we agree to this, if the board agrees to this, there's nothing you can do to get out of it other than to have the county amend it, which they're not going to likely do. And so I can't imagine that it's at all objectionable. The only thing that I could possibly imagine that we might get any form of pushback on from a substantive perspective would be the ability to actually go to the county and ask for an emergency or critical need allowance. Mm-hmm. But quite candidly, you've got to have that. You have to at least have the ability to go ask for that. I can't imagine that would be objectionable to the county. Maybe it would be, but you have to have that ability. If you get if you get hit with either an emergency situation or some type of an unfunded mandate that this district has to comply with but can't raise its rate above and is stuck between a rock and a hard place, you have to be able to go to the county and explain that situation to them and have them at least consider and approve that allowance or give consideration to that allowance. And it's the same approval method that's in the county charter right now for the other agencies that can go ask for the same thing. It's a supermajority vote, so it's not even just a simple majority. It's a four-member vote that you'd have to go get and obtain. Mm. So that is intended to avoid the abuses that you might run into if you kept asking for critical needs that weren't necessarily critical. So that is the only thing that I can possibly think would be objectionable. Everything else is exactly accordance to what the law provides right now.
That's fine. So thank you.
Yep. That's it.
Is there something in here? I read this, but you know how it goes. Commissioner Tobai can back out of it?
Well, he doesn't.
If we sign this, if we get this signed, if we all agree to this, is there a way that he can say, well, that's nice that you agreed, but now.
Candidly, he doesn't have to do anything. He doesn't even have to agree to this.
Well, he didn't have to do anything to start this.
He doesn't.
You know, I mean.
No, I'm just advising you. If the board passes this agreement, and it's a board issue, it's a county commission issue, so you can't really frame it as if Commissioner Tobia will or won't approve this, although I suspect that the commission will defer to his wisdom with regard to his district. But he's not obligated to agree to this. If the board approves it tonight, we're going to send it to the county with the hope and the request that they would approve of it as well.
So the point is that we approve this, and then they can just say, too bad.
If they don't agree to it, then the agreement doesn't take effect. And then you're living with the consequences of whatever the referendum are, and then you're not, and then if the referendum's defeated, you're not bound by the terms of the agreement.
The point is that this is what he wants, so we're saying, yes, this is what you want.
Yeah, well,
we will agree
to
it.
Yeah, Mike, this is what he says he wants, but I mean...
You won't know what he wants until he gets it and signs it or he doesn't.
I think he's been very clear about what he wants in this agreement.
But there's nothing we can do about that. Only a choice we have is to approve it. We don't have any other choice.
No, that's not the only choice we have. Are we convinced that we can't win the referendum?
Every referendum, I think, that has ever been gone before the people here has been defeated.
Well, this isn't a spending referendum. This isn't a spending referendum. This is a totally different animal. And the risk would be huge.
Has anything ever been passed? I'm not sure. I'm not sure.
In terms of initiatives that have been put out to exceed the spending cap, there has not been one that has passed.
The term limits passed.
Term
limits.
But this referendum is about whether we pull this. This is we decide whether we pull the collection process from the county and move it back into Barefoot Bay, right?
The referendum question is worded to say, does the voter approve of the revocation of BBRD, the district's ability to collect this assessment via the uniform method of tax collection?
And
that's how the question is worded.
Yeah, and it's a risky proposition, I think, to look at that. But I don't know. I mean, that is an option. That's an option to go through with that and try to get the community support to understand the consequence of that not passing. Because we've got some issues we're going to have to deal with if we lay down and accept the CPI as our standard for increases. We don't know what the next, we're probably good for a year or two, but after that, who knows? I guess I'm wanting to discuss it. I'm not necessarily opposed to the interlocal agreement, but I mean, it's like we're just saying it's a done deal and we have no other alternatives here, and maybe we do.
I tend to agree with Roger, so.
I'd like to speak to it a little bit. I think that we really don't want to overcomplicate this thing too much. So basically, we're looking at a real simple thing. We're looking at the county commissioner wants us to approve that we will never raise higher than CPI. Which is, for those at home, that's a consumer price
index.
So currently that consumer price index is about 2.3 average. And if we agree to that, then he is agreeing to pull another piece of this referendum, which is how we collect our district fees. And right now, currently, we collect them at a very high percentage rate in the high 90s through the county, through the tax assessment. So let's look at for a second at what CPI means to us and what our annual raises and our district fees have been in the past 15 years. In the past 15 years, our average, if we averaged out every raise that we've ever had for 15 years, our average has only been 1.32. If we average out what the CPI has been for the past 15 years, that average is 2.03. So the CPI is actually much higher than what we've actually raised and what we've actually done. If you look at that in cumulative dollars, we would have collected from our community $6,632,755.55 more if we had been CPI all along, if we had been following a CPI rule all along.
Randy,
so
actually we're about $7 lower than what is right here indicating.
What's that?
We're $7 lower than what?
I'm just going by what Charles gave me.
Yeah, that's the one I'm talking about.
Yeah. But to keep it simple, CPI for us going forward just basically means that there will be an increase every year. That increase will be for the next year anyway, next year would be about 2.3% increase compared to our last year, 3.3%. I don't have a problem with CPI. When I look at the legal ease that the referendum for the ballot is written, man, that's confusing. It is just confusing. If it goes on the ballot, we've got a problem there. If it goes on the ballot, and let's say that this was back in May when it was actually written by the county commissioners or by whoever decided to put it out there, if we look back in May and we had that information in May, then we would be able to educate our community because we wouldn't be up against early voting, mail-in voting, and everything. And right now, we're just days from early voting and mail-in voting. We don't have enough time to get out and educate a community on what this vote actually means before half of them, perhaps, have already gotten out there and voted. We have a voting block of about 5,000 people in Barefoot Bay that we would have to reach out to, and that's nonpartisan. That's just Democrats and Republicans that we would have to get out, get the information out to. And I don't know that we have a vehicle that's big enough, fast enough, or mighty enough to get that out on what that would mean if they vote yes to approve bringing that, revoking that collection method. My concern is not how much we're collecting or how much we'll collect in the future, because based on past history, we'll end up collecting more. I mean, $6 million is higher than what we've collected. My concern is getting it is going to be down on the next item that we're not talking about yet. That's my bigger concern, is getting it off of the ballot and making sure that it doesn't get revoked. So I just wanted to put that out there as simply as I could, meaning that we're looking at a difference in CPI versus what the board has to decide every year on how much to levy the increase in district fees. And we're looking at the threat of collection method. So if we just keep those two things in mind as we look forward, it might help us get to where we need to be easier.
Thank you, Randy.
Can I just say something? When you were talking about how much the assessment was raised in the past 15 years, for a number of those years, there was no raise at all. There was not 1 cent raised on the assessment.
To be exact, it's eight of the 15.
And so that, I mean, your figures don't really add up to anything because there was a number, I don't know how many years was it, 6 years?
That eight.
There was no,
eight.
8 years, eight there was years. No raise in the assessment. So that really doesn't make, you know, if it was 1.2 or whatever you said it was, I mean, it's not a fair number. I just thought I'd throw that in.
But I think Randy's point is valid, though, that if we would have been on the CPI all those years, we would have been making a hell of a lot of money.
We'd be in good shape.
But they voted not to raise
it. I understand that he's trying to say, though, that if you have the CPI in there and it was going all along, you would have actually been increasing rather than not increasing.
Yeah, but they voted not to raise it.
The press did not even discuss the raising.
No,
so that's what I think she's going at.
But if it was in the future now, if you just base it on the past, in the future, we would still be getting, you know, we're talking right now a difference of $24 a year on each parcel or $16 a year. You know, you're talking $8 a year. If $8 a year is going to break us right now, then we're not managing our money very well. In order to get out of this and not have to hire staff, not have to do thousands of transactions collecting monthly, not have to go through all these things of people not paying their taxes, and one of the people who talked at the commissioner's meeting absolutely does not want to pay taxes, doesn't think they should have to pay the assessment. There are a lot of people like that, and we will not be able to collect our assessment. So the idea is, again, the simplest way to get out of this problem is to pass this agreement, send it to the commissioners, let him sign it, and hopefully they get it off the ballot immediately.
I was going to make governing, but I'm not going to say nothing right now. So, but since anybody else got anything to say?
I just want to say that I think Mike's right with a lot of things he said. On the other hand, I don't trust Tobias.
This is not a personal issue. This is a committee.
Yeah. It's not a matter of trust.
It's not a matter of trust at this point. It's a matter of whether you believe that this is in the best interest of the district. If you do, and we send it to the county will review it, and they will look at it. And if they have edits, they will send them, or if they have problems with it, they'll let me know. But I can assure you, based on my conversations with Commissioner Tobias, his singular issue is limitation of the assessment rate to CPI. And if we do that, if we have accomplished doing that via this vehicle, he's going to be okay with that. That is his issue. So he's not interested in anything else. That's his issue. The question is whether this accomplishes that to his satisfaction, and whether you think that this is an acceptable resolution. And if you do, then we're going to explore that with him and the commission and their legal staff, and hopefully we'll work it out.
Yeah, I think the continued collection of our assessments by the county is imperative. I don't think we can afford not to do that. So, I would make a motion that we accept this interlocal agreement that's been presented to us by Mr. Reppinger. We approve it, that we get it in, and that we move forward. We fortunately have other avenues available to us to raise revenue here in the Bay if we see that there's going to be some shortfall. But we've got to get past this and protect that county collection of our assessment.
I would second that motion.
Roger made a motion, seconded by Mr. Mino. Any other discussion on that motion? Hearing none, we will now have a vote on it, a voice vote. Trustee Mino?
Yes.
Trustee Klosky? No. Trustee Henderson? What was that?
No.
Okay. Trustee Compton?
Yes.
Trustee Loveland?
Yes.
Motion passes 3-2.
We will send that off to the county immediately, and hopefully we will be able to meet any deadline that we can to get it off the ballot. If not, we will revisit it. Stay tuned. One additional thing that I would ask, if you could make a motion, understanding that you've accepted this agreement and the principle that's in it, to approve of any non-substantive technical edits that need to be made to the agreement as may be proposed by the county, and then we can bring it back and have it ratified if we need to.
I would make that motion exactly what he said. I was thinking about that earlier, and I had a note here, and I forgot to bring it up. Yeah.
There was a motion. Need a second?
I'll second.
Randy made a second. Any discussion on that motion? If none, all in favor of that motion with a voice?
Aye.
Mr. Mino?
Aye.
Luann? Roger?
Yes.
Randy? Joe? No.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is the phase reopen discussion. John?
At the last meeting, the two trustees questioned the tee times. I communicated that to the board last Friday. Mr. Cruz is on vacation this week, but I feel comfortable I can address any concerns. So staff recommends no changes.
Board?
Yeah, I've got a couple of questions.
Luann, do you want to go or want me to go? Oh, he's talking about tee times. Anything? No.
I read did Ernie send it out, or Mike, John, did you send it out? I read it. I understand his position, and the problem probably will be when everybody gets back in the fall. I would like to see it shortened, but that's how I feel.
Well, I have I talked to John about this, and I also agree with most of the things that's in Mr. Cruz's letter. However, We've made changes to a number of things, pools, exercise classes. We've added things. We've gotten a little bit away. And the way we have it now with 16 minutes, especially at this time of the year, and this is not a burning issue, but it is something I think we have to consider. And I hate bringing things up simply because I'm part of the golf course community. But, you know, right now the way we have it, we can get three tee times in 1 hour if you base them on a 16 minutes. Three, maybe four, depending on how you count 60 minutes. If we simply went down to 12-minute tee times, we would get 5 to 6 more tee times in during the period 7:30 in the morning till 12:30 in the afternoon, which is the peak period right now. We'd be able to get 5 or 6 more tee times in closer together. People wouldn't have to wait. Right now, as I mentioned to John the other day, at 11:30 the other day, when I was the last group to tee off in our Monday group, there was literally nobody else out there. We had 20 to 25 carts available in the barn. This may all change as you get into the end of September, October, but really and truly, there's no need for extra staff. There's no anything. It's just simply adding possibly 5 more tee times in a 5-hour period or 6-hour. You know, it's just minuscule, really, when you look at it. And so I'm all in favor, or if it's allowed, I would make, and I'm not sure, I'm not trying to run the golf course. I'm not trying to tell them how to manage this thing. But I'm simply suggesting we move from a 16-minute tee time down to a 12-minute tee time and see how it goes. If things go bad in the end of September, you can always change it and go back.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think that we could at least try it. We could at least, you know, for the next, in September, from now until the end of September, give it a shot, see how it goes. Because in October, people are going to start coming back.
Well, the only thing I understand with the, what is it, 16 minutes, the reason why it was 16 minutes is because so the people don't be all close together and more
right.
Gathering.
And the way it is now, though, you know, people are not, they congregate after. You know,
okay.
They go in the parking lot, they go in their carts, and we can't control a whole lot of that. But again, we have people meeting in the buildings also, and
okay.
Clubs are meeting, and things are happening. So we're not opening the bars. We're not opening up the 19th hole. We're not ever suggesting anything like that. I'm not suggesting we go to 8 minutes. But to simply cut off 4 minutes so that when you're standing out there and the group in front of you is now almost two and a half holes ahead of you, we're playing golf. You're not all together out there,
okay.
And you're simply standing there waiting, and there's nobody playing anyway. I guess for now I would make a motion, and I'm not sure if it's appropriate, or do we just ask staff to take this into consideration? I'm not sure, John.
My recommendation would be to turn it to staff and let them look at it and see how that falls.
Well, the other thing, though, is if you do that and you say we're turning it to Ernie will say no because he's already said no.
Yeah.
And I just don't agree with that. I agree that it's 16 should be cut to 12.
If you want to mandate 12-minute tee times, you need to make a motion. And Trustee Henderson had suggested like a sunset to it, so you may either want to have a sunset or when you want to revisit tee times if the board's going to start setting tee times.
To make a motion, you can do and put that, include that.
I would make a motion that we again, as we are doing with a lot of other things here, putting pools in, putting exercise classes in, we're making a lot of changes to things as we go along, that we go down to a 12-minute tee time. And when you're talking about sunset, are we saying we should revisit it possibly in our September meeting? What meeting? I'm not sure what the meetings are, what dates they are.
September 11th is the first meeting. September's only.
Yeah,
the second
meeting in September that we would revisit it, whatever that date is. Yeah.
22nd. Okay.
I made a motion. I'll second the motion.
Okay. Any other discussion on the motion?
I don't typically disagree with Mike. I think that I have a lot of respect for him and his opinion. What I don't like is I don't like taking a vote to usurp or override a manager, and that I've got a little indigestion over that. I don't like us doing that on any level, whether it's golf or whether it's pool times or whether it's how many can be in the pool, or any of that. We have a management team that put together a good disaster plan, and I think that they're capable of running that. And I think that if Ernie's wrong, then John would be the one to jump in there and say, no, Ernie, you're going to do this. I'm not comfortable from a board perspective jumping in and usurping a manager's decision. I just wanted that real clear.
And I understand that, but didn't we do those kinds of things with exercise groups and stuff in the pool? We're the ones who made the motions to put those things in. That's the same thing. We usurp people there. The management's right. We said, no, you put this in. You put this group in.
I don't recall it being a motion to put it in. I recall it being a discussion.
We did not
have a formal motion on the floor. And I'm all about having a discussion. I'm just not sure I want to make a formal motion and then have to deal. And I think John probably, I mean, he closed his comment with, and then we'll meet again to discuss the next tea time. I don't want to start setting all the tea times.
No, I don't either, Randy. You're right.
Y'all had a consensus at the last meeting to add AquaZumba.
Right. It wasn't a formal. Okay.
I'm not trying to do that either. I tried to say that I was not trying to tell people how to run things. However, so I withdraw my motion. I withdraw it. Okay?
Why you withdraw yours?
I withdraw.
Yeah, withdraw. And instead, I would make a strong recommendation to the administration that the tee times at the golf course be changed from 16 minutes to 12 minutes. And then they evaluate that as we go forward. So as a BOT member, I'm making that strong recommendation.
So in other words, you're passing it to John, and John can have a talk with Randy, Ernie on that discussion. Am I correct?
I'm sorry?
I don't care who they talk to.
I'm just making
John
a strong recommendation. Tee times be changed from 16 minutes to 12 minutes.
Okay.
That I have much more appetite for that.
Okay.
Thank you.
I'd also I've also had calls on the pool room being open and use of the equipment, and I just wanted to be John. Can you explain why the pool room? And I have a feeling it's because of disinfecting, and the equipment is probably the same thing. And when I say equipment, I mean bocce ball equipment.
My understanding, it is available upon request if we have time to disinfect it. The pool room, I don't know anybody been in there recently, but it's not that big a room, and we would have to disinfect it after each room. But I don't know how, unless you're playing pool by yourself, you're pretty close to each other. We can do it if you want. It just, it's like the card room. We're going to open the card room and have people in there playing cards. Everything we open up more, and I can just to deviate back for the folks at home who don't play golf and stuff. It's not that Mr. Cruz and I are against trying to get people out playing golf earlier in the morning, but we're trying to ensure a level of sanitation. And yes, not every time a person shows up to play golf, but on last Sunday morning, our person in charge, associate golf professional, probably got his title wrong, Mr. Balish, had to go out and tell people to go back to the parking lot or they weren't going to get to play golf because they were wanting to congregate in real close. And all it takes is one golfer who play golf regularly to get COVID, and we're shutting the course down. If anybody who ever saw Randy Fine's chest x-ray after he got out of the hospital, the death rate's real low, but he's got health complications for months on end, and he survived. So if the board wants us to loosen up, we can. I wouldn't play pool in that room. It's a small room. Part of our strategy is if we had, like, say I get COVID, The admin building shut down for 3 days. It doesn't take 3 days to clean the admin building. The 3 days is to try to let the particles disperse out of the air and stuff. The more active the community gets, the greater chance we have of further shutdowns. It's whatever level comfort the folks have. We hear people complain about pool two not being open. And Mr. Klosky shows me Facebook postings now and then. This afternoon at 2 o'clock, there were 4 golf carts and 10 cars at pool one. And 2 of those belonged to our staff who was working. So this board will remember a lot of people talking about open the pools. We have very little use once we opened it up. When we opened the lounge for that week before the state shuts back down, we never came close to 50% of our reduced capacity. So we can do whatever you want. It's just if we're going to try to ensure an adequate level of sanitation, there is a level where we have, if we're going to have more open or more activity, we have to add more staff. I don't say this to be braggadocious, but a matter of fact, most of the trustees are aware that the managers and I in the admin building, we do the daily midday cleaning now because we're trying to decrease the number of custodians who come into our buildings. So it's all hands on deck right now, and it's a level of comfort that every person is going to have a difference of opinion on. There's no right or wrong. If you want us to open the pool room, we can.
No, I want to be real clear. That's not at all what I'm saying. You know, I think that as a trustee, every one of our obligation is when homeowners come to us with a question, that we bring that question forward for an answer, and that's all I'm doing. I will always continue to support you and your staff in the pandemic plan that you have, but I will also bring forth questions when homeowners ask.
And I also, Mr. Coffey, I commend the staff for what they're doing, and I'm not ever trying to get you to change the plans and the things you're doing, and I compliment Bill for going out and tell people, get out of here, stay away from here, you're not supposed to be here yet. That's what they should be doing. That's what all of our staff should be doing. I have no problem with that. I also think, though, that when you talk about certain things can be changed as the staff looks at them because they say, well, you know, we could really do this to accommodate some people and it wouldn't hurt. I don't think you can compare putting those people in that pool room to people playing golf. I mean, it's, you know, those are two different things. I agree that if this came to a decision of the BOT of whether we're going to open up that tiny pool room and put people in there, I would not be in favor of that. If we were talking about going to 6-minute tee times or 8-minute tee times and having everybody come there and come, I am not in favor of that at all. But I still think you have to look at things as we go along, and if there's a little glitch or a little thing, you say, well, this could improve it without affecting the safety, then that's what you people do. And you do a very good job of it. If Bill went out and told those people the other day that they shouldn't be congregating, I compliment him. I really, truly do.
Thank you. Anyone else? So we're going to leave just the way it is for another 2 weeks then. Okay, thank you. Next, the discussion of tabling of large up-and-coming projects enacted by BOT on August 14, 2020 meeting. That's Randy's.
Yeah, I want to clarify what I meant by that.
Okay, I know. Okay, Luann meant put that on the thing. Go ahead, Luann.
Randy, put it on the agenda. Randy, no, I did because I was at the pro shop and Ernie said he had to cancel something about the God, my brain went dead. But the water, about the irrigation system, because we voted to not have any more things on these large projects.
But
when you brought it up, I thought you were just talking about the dog park, because I think the dog park's going to be a big contentious thing, and I think the thing with John Tobai sort of. We needed to concentrate on that. And I thought that it was just the dog park that you were talking about.
The way I understand is we don't do any kind of projects that are not budgeted or even in the thing there. So That's why that I presume the trustees do understand that we do not do projects if they're not budgeted.
What you're referring to? No. Let me clarify.
Okay.
I did mean the dog park because it was a new project. I meant any new project that was not already previously accepted within the budget, meaning that if we want to put a diving board in at Pool 2, that's a new project. If, you know, not projects that are already budgeted that are in process.
Okay, I see what
you mean.
Or that
are already planned within the budget. I did not mean any of those projects, large or small. I meant any project that has not come before the board, been approved, and or in the budget.
That's how I understood, Randy, also.
That's what I understood.
Well, that's how I understood it. And then Ernie said that he was told not to.
Because I know when that happened, I thought to myself, what was that about? Why did I vote on it? But then if they're not budgeted, the staff is not going to do anything on it and bring it up to the board, so.
Well, let me make it, if I could, I'd like to make a new motion to clarify it.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. I make a motion that we not entertain any new projects that are not currently on the budget or slated to be on the budget and that have not been financed.
And I'll second that.
So just to make it completely clear, you're just really talking about, at this point, the dog park, right?
No.
Well, what else?
It could be anything.
I'm talking about anything else.
Somebody could want to put in a trailer park, I mean a mobile home storage park. We'd say, no, it's not budgeted.
Exactly. Thank you, Mike.
Right. Okay. I just want to
smell like
be
I want. I want it real clear. I'm not picking on the dog park.
Like Randy, you just said, a diving board or something like that. As a pool.
Well, I'm voting for a diving board. That's going
pool
in.
Too. So, go ahead. Yeah.
I want to see these people on a diving board.
I'm not directing this to any trustee comment, but just folks at home. We don't work on projects that are not in the budget. We have enough work that already is on the budget. So I didn't want folks at home thinking my staff was going rogue working on diving boards and things that nobody has talked about. We have our hands full with what we have before us.
I agree with you, John. I know there's so. Okay, there was a motion, a second. So all in favor of that motion, please say aye.
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 Motion passes. Thank you very much.
So that's a no on a diving board, huh? Okay.
Wow, I was looking forward to that diving board.
John, the next one we're not gonna.
So the trustee belly flop competition is out.
It's out.
Okay, yes, sorry about that. 90.
On the next,
we do that every meeting.
Are we gonna not discuss and just put it at a future meeting? The impact of losing the ability.
Already made.
There's no need to discuss it now. We've already discussed it.
I don't think there's a need to discuss it now.
Okay, so
do we need a motion to remove it, or are you just?
You could make a motion to either remove it or continue it to a future agenda.
I would make a motion that we remove item 9A from the agenda pending the outcome of other litigation things that we have ongoing.
On second.
Second.
It's not really litigation. It's
what's that?
Any other discussion on that motion?
Just negotiations.
The negotiations.
There you go.
And who made the second?
I did.
Okay. Any discussion on the motion? Hearing none. All in favor of that motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion passes. Next is the FY21 assessment roll.
Mr. Chairman, trustees, residents at home, this is the annual housekeeping of board adopted the assessment rate back in June with the budget. This is certifying the assessment roll, which lists each property and what they pay that is required to be submitted to the tax collector on time. Staff recommends approval. There is a resolution for Mr. Reppinger to read.
Go ahead.
Resolution 2020-10, a resolution of the Board of Trustees of the Barefoot Bay Recreation District providing for the preparation, adoption, and authorization of certification of a non-ad valorem assessment roll, providing for corrections of errors and omissions, providing for conflicts, providing an effective date.
Chair will entertain a motion under resolution.
I'll make a motion that we accept the resolution as read.
I'd second.
Mr. Meyer made a say. Any discussion on that motion? Hearing none. All in favor of that motion, please say aye.
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 Motion passes. Thank you. Next is the employees' insurance renewal. And there'll be six motions made on this because there's different plans.
Yes.
Go ahead, John.
Chairman Klosky and I, this is our favorite one of the year because it's so complicated. Within the budget was various insurances for employees that some are paid partly by the district, some are 100% paid by the employees. The agenda memo is broken out per type, and as Mr. Klosky referenced, we typically have a motion on each one. Health insurance, this is the second year we've had a very favorable renewal of 2.9%. The board has in the past made an effort to try to increase the district's portion from the historic low rate of 75% to 90% due to things we've talked way too much about today already. My recommendation is to hold at 85% this year, see how other things settle out. That would basically have a the budget is slightly less overall. What's complicating this presentation is we have the standard plan and then we have two, quote, affordable plans. We recommend they're all at 85%. The highlighted ones are if the board wanted to increase it, the contributions. And we do have three employees who have dependent coverage at this point. And so rather than really making your eyes bleed with the three different plans, I grouped the cost below. Overall, we've had an increase in the number of employees electing coverage. A few years ago, we had 20 out of 30 employees electing coverage. We estimate we'll be at 27 out of 34 eligible employees. At the in that 87.5 is a wrong, I'm sorry. So the renewal recommendation is at 85% with the current plans at a cost of $298,913, which is a savings of approximately $25,000 from the budget. The chart here shows the progress we've made over the last few years. If there's any questions, Mr. Armington or I can answer them.
Chair will entertain a motion.
I make a motion that we accept staff recommendation.
Second.
I'll second.
Any discussion on that motion? Go ahead.
So just how many of our staff does this can you hear me? How many of the staff does this affect?
Pre-pandemic layoffs, we have about during the height of our busy season, we have about 115 employees. 34 of those are full-time employees. So we estimate that based on current enrollment and positions that we're aware of that are new, that 27 of those. So,
I see it.
And that's always the unknown as we've grown over the years of people electing our coverage versus being on their spouse's coverage. It's increased our costs, but just a few years ago, we were in the double-digit renewals. I won't try to guess why we've had 2 years of low renewal, but I appreciate it.
Could you go down, John, and go to, let's see, are we below that, or am I, okay, so look, okay, so I'm just trying to understand it. I mean, I know insurances are difficult. So we negotiate, we meaning the administration, meaning you or whoever, negotiates with insurance companies to get our insurance. Is that correct? And the employees do not do this.
No.
They're not involved at all.
These are group rates.
Okay.
We have, over the 7 years I've been here, we switched plans twice.
Okay.
And we're back to where we started, basically. Most of the employees are very happy with Health First, which is the provider. Overall, The employees have been very appreciative of past boards' efforts to reduce their costs. It is part of a compensation package that employees look at. While not painting with a broad brush, a lot of our full-time employees are the more semi-skilled managerial people. That's not to say every employee is not valuable, but, you know.
Can you tell me, I don't want employees, but can you tell me, an employee taking this coverage and taking, do we call it family coverage or dependent coverage, okay, whatever, what are they paying a month for that?
We have that in the detail. Let me find it for you.
And I'm just looking for a rough, you know, rough number of what we're paying and what they're paying.
Okay. It depends which plan you're on. If you're going to the typical plan,
okay,
these are broken into monthly costs. Let me back up and go a different route because that 175 is 85% of the cost per month. So let me just real quickly figure out.
Okay, that's fine. So you're saying the 175 is 85%?
Yes.
Not 175. Where are you looking?
171.
171. Yeah. Okay. Okay, that's fine. That's fine. And so they're paying. I can almost do it in my head, but
$30 a month.
Yeah.
For that's individual employee coverage.
Okay. And without going to a lot of other graphs, just so I understand it, what kind of a plan is that? Deductible, for instance, is what? How much?
Okay, that goes back to that one. There's no deductible. There's 80% coinsurance. Annual out of pocket is $2,000 per for the employee. $4,000 for if you have family coverage.
Okay.
The quote affordable Obamacare plans. Their affordability is in the premiums. One of the plans here. There's $6,000 deductible and then $6,000 out of pocket.
Right.
So it's affordable, and forgive me if I offend anybody's political leanings, it's affordable if you don't use the plan. If you use your health insurance on a somewhat limited basis, the standard plan is less money out of your pocket. If you don't use your health insurance at all, and we have some employees who like that, who just want a catastrophic plan. The Obamacare plans are cheaper, and they're taking a gamble. They're not going to be in the hospital and have $6,000 out of pocket.
Sure, sure. Okay, thank you.
It was a motion made and second. No other discussion? Hearing no other discussion. All in favor of that motion, please say aye.
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 Motion passes. Thank you. Next is your dental.
Yes, on dental, we estimate 32 out of 34 eligible employees. There is no cost renewal to the current plan that we have. We did get asked for alternate quote, and there's one that's a higher cost. So therefore, we recommend, and this again, we pay 75% of the dental, but it's much less. You see, the employee cost is basically $6 a month for that. We recommend the board award contract for dental insurance to the principal PPO plan at a cost of $7,672.
Chair will entertain a motion.
I'll make that motion.
Mr. Minor made a motion. Second. Luann seconded. Any discussion on that motion? Hearing none. All in favor of that motion, please say aye.
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 Motion passes. Next one is the group life and AD&D insurance.
This is a relatively new benefit for our employees. This was added a few years ago. This is 100% paid by the district. It provides $10,000 life insurance. There is an age deduction as you get older. There's no cost renewal from FY20. We recommend award contract to principal at the amount of $1,146.48.
Chair will entertain a motion. Luann made a motion. Second?
I'll second.
Roger seconded. Any discussion on that motion? Hearing none. All in favor of that motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes. Next is the Vision Insurance.
The Vision is 100% employee paid. The current plan offered a zero renewal rate. We recommend sticking with principal VSP choice at no cost to BBRD.
Chair will entertain a motion.
I would make that motion. We accept it.
Mr. Minor made a motion. Second. Luann seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor of that motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes. Next is the supplemental short-term disability insurance.
Once again, this is 100% employee paid. Rather than bleeding your eyes with all the age tables, we presented a typical age for an employee. There's no cost increase to this. Staff recommends award contract for voluntary short-term disability insurance at zero cost to BBRD to principal.
Chair will entertain a motion.
I'll second.
A motion, second. Any discussion on that motion? Hearing none. All in favor of that motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes. Next, the final one is supplement, submittal, life and accidental death and dismemberment, AD and AD insurance.
Chairman Klosky, you're doing this so good, I'm afraid you're going to take my job next year. once again, there's no cost increase to this, 100% paid by the employees. Recommend award contract to principal for supplemental life, accidental death, and dismemberment at zero cost to BBRD.
Chair will entertain a motion. Luann made a motion. Second.
Second.
Mr. Minor, second. Any discussion on that motion? Hearing none. All in favor of that motion, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you very much.
And if I can just wrap it up.
Go ahead.
And in summary, we had a total of $332,907 budgeted for the insurances. The renewals saved us from our budget of $25,175. Once Mr. Henley is done with the audit, he will prepare a budget amendment to move the monies to contingency.
Thank you. Okay, manager's report, John.
Resident relations, ARC meeting on the 25th, 21 consent items approved, 6 others approved, 2 old business approved. Next meeting is on September 1st with 30 items on the agenda. Violations meeting on the 14th, 24 cases. As typical, half of them came into compliance before the meeting. 2 are working with the homeowners are working with DOR staff for voluntary compliance, and 12 were found in violation. The next meeting is on the 28th with 12 cases. Pro Shop is still working on the selective herbicide and reference the report back to y'all. Property services, it's a short list, but a very packed list. We are on the home stretch on the miniature golf. The fence is up, the pavers are in, the water fountain is installed, working on final painting, benches are being placed, walking paths between holes. It's something that you're going to have to wait and see. It doesn't make sense hearing it or being laid out. For the folks who say it's a not a very challenging course, I think they'll be pleasantly surprised or sadly surprised based on their scores. Begin replacing the benches around the lake as a response to resident complaints. There's been a flurry of dropping off and picking up animal traps for residents that we do free of charge. The majority of the work of the Bill Nay sound system upgrade partly offset by a donation by Little Theater, is completed. They will be back this Friday to show us how everything works and make the last adjustments. Mr. Getz and Ms. Mendes have been reviewing the latest updated pages for the lake lounge and lakeside expansion construction projects. Mr. Getz, Ms. Mendes, and I each are making our daily inspections of the Building A renovation project. Mr. Getz's folks worked with Ms. Brown's folks on the supervisor elections use of this building, and as usual, cut a lot of grass in the neighborhoods for DOR violations. A couple housekeeping issues. Next meeting, we'll have the FY22 budget preparation schedule on the calendar. If there's any changes the board wishes, we appreciate your input then. And a teaser of more good news coming next week regarding the budget. We received our renewal forms for workers' compensation and general liability from Florida Municipal Insurance Trust, which we have a two-year rate guarantee for this year. Our modifier, which 1.00 is normal claims, remains at 0.76, same as last year. Long-term residents and Mr. Klosky will remember the days not too long ago where we were double the normal cost for our workers' comp. The 24% savings from the normal claims rate is a testament to the managers and supervisors who routinely incorporate safety and best practices into their work and training routine. Awarded that contract will be on the September 11th agenda. And that concludes my report.
Any questions for John? Okay. Attorney Major.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. With everything going on, we've got a lot of the drafting has been done on those complaints. I just haven't had a time to update the status list for you. I'm going to try to get that out by the end of the week. I think I said that last time, but hopefully I will live up to my word this time, and I will get that to you by the end of the week. So, and that's all the update I have for tonight.
Thank you. And settling remarks, Randy.
Well, I really don't have any tonight. I want to thank Cliff and John for their work with Tobiah. I know that Friday before last, it was a frenzy of phone calls back and forth. And I know you guys have been working really hard. And I want to thank Cliff for not setting his hair on fire. That's about it.
That's it?
I would like to mention since January, Brevard County Road and Bridges has resurfaced between a mile and a half of road here in Barefoot Bay at a cost of $150,000 a mile. We had the collapse at Dottie Lane, and that was repaired along with the weir that was having an effect on the drainage in our canals here in the bay. That project was originally estimated at $300,000. I suspect when they got there and they realized it had fully collapsed, it turned into a somewhat more costly exercise than $300,000. And, of course, most everybody in the bay has been around the four-way stop, and we know that after about 3 years or so, they're there now repairing that. That's very good to see, and I think if you see the extensive rerouting that they had to do to correct that problem, that's got to be an extremely costly project for them too, and I can understand why there was some delay. So, and there may be some other drainage and problems that Road and Bridges has worked for us this year here in the Bay, but I've got to believe that Brevard County Road and Bridges has invested somewhere north of $500,000 so far this year, maybe closer to $750,000 here in Barefoot Bay. And if you look at your tax rolls, we pay just a ballpark of about $5 per lot to the county roads and bridges. And that, you know, just some easy to calculate numbers, that's probably somewhere around $25,000 a year that we contribute to that fund, but yet we're receiving over $500,000 in return from that. So I only bring this up to help the community be aware that we're certainly getting our money's worth out of the county roads and bridges here in the Bay, and to thank that group in the county for investing, for continuing to invest in Barefoot Bay to make sure that, you know, that our infrastructure is intact and in place, and our roads are nice here in the Bay, and it really adds to our community to have good roads, good drainage, and that sort of thing. And that's all I have to say.
Thank you. Luann? Nothing? Okay.
No, I'm fine. Thank you. Nope.
Whoa, okay. I just want to thank the board for everything. Thank the staff for everything. And our next meeting will be on September 11th on a Friday afternoon right here in D&E. And I also like to wish everybody a happy Labor Day, which is September the 7th. So enjoy yourself. Relax that day because it's a day off. Chair will now entertain a motion. Meeting adjourned. Thank you.
I'll second that.
Thank you. Y'all have a good evening.